Hello, having defined subprograms in the last video and looked at some of the key terms like calling and definition and stuff like that, let's now look at procedures in a bit more detail and how we answer questions related to these. We'll just look at parameters, which apply to both procedures and functions, because subprogram is our overriding term. We've got two types of subprogram at GCSE at least, which are procedures and functions. The thing we'll look at later, parameters apply to both of these. However, procedures don't return a value. Functions do return a value, so returning a value we'll look at in the functions video, which will come next. Structurally, procedures and functions are very similar. What we looked at in the last video, I showed an example with a procedure, but it would look similar with a function, just with a slight tweak. So let's look at a potential example exam question. A procedure, countdown, should output the integers between 10 and 1 inclusive, counting down. After these are outputted, it should then output launch. We need to write the procedure countdown. So it's told us what the name of this procedure should be, and it's told us what it should do. We just need to write the definition. It doesn't mention calling anywhere in the question, therefore I'm just writing the definition. So the syntax in OCR exam reference language is to first of all write the word procedure. In Python it would be def, but it's procedure in ERL. You then write down the name of your subprogram, which we've been told is countdown, and it's shown us with empty brackets. So we always put empty brackets afterwards. There can be things in the brackets called parameters we'll look at in a couple of minutes. That's our opening line of our definition. Now, what code needs to go inside it? Well, this code here has got nothing to do with subprograms. It's to do with what you've learned already, which are for loops, right? The word sub or the two word subprogram is a small program. You know, it's like a mini program. These things you would be able to hopefully do by this point. And we just put it inside our definition. So this should be a for loop. I'm going to write it in OCR ERL. I'm going to indent it so it's more clear to read. And we want I to initially be 10 because I'm starting at 10. I want I to go down to 1. And I want to this time count down. So my step should be minus 1, not plus 1. I'm simply going to print I. I'm going to write next I, which is how OCR ERL shows for loops. And then I've also got to output launch after these are outputted. Therefore, I'm going to output this after the for loop is finished. I'm going to print launch down here. All of this, like I say, not really being relevant to subprograms. We're just packaging it inside our procedure. And now how do we end a procedure in ERL? Well, we write the single word end procedure like you do with end while or end if. It shows this block of code has finished. I've completed my definition. So just because they're asking for you to do procedures or functions, it doesn't mean it's necessarily much harder. You've just got to package what you already know into a definition. So these brackets here are empty currently. However, we can have things inside these brackets. Now these things are called parameters. And we use parameters to give the subprogram values to use. And to define them more formally, parameters are special variables used to input values to a subprogram. They work like variables. We've got certain special variables like the I in a for loop. We've also got parameters which are special for subprograms. So in the first example I showed you in the video where it was asking the user their name and then saying it's good to see you, followed by their name, use an input line. However, I might not want to use an input line. Here, I've just modified my code to add a parameter. So we can see here, I've only got one parameter. I can have multiple. I give it a name. Unfortunately, I've called it name here as well. I've given it an identifier because it is a variable. And I'm using this parameter in my code, in my procedure. And really, it's being used as a placeholder because I don't necessarily know what the name of our user is going to be. Previously, I asked the user themselves using an input line. Here, I've decided not to ask the user. I've instead called it with a value. So it's really, really important if you've got a parameter, every parameter you have, you must add a value in when you call it. So name is assigned a value when called. When this line runs, name is being subbed out for Mr. Brown. When the procedure finishes, Mr. Brown gets forgotten about, and name kind of resets to being just a placeholder for the next calling line. And this offers me a lot more versatility because I can just simply change this value to refer to somebody else. and I've not had to bother the user in doing this. I can just modify what it's doing, and I can add in multiple calling lines if I want to, with different values. So it makes it a lot more versatile. I can just add in loads of different calling lines, and it is adapting the code based on this value. So parameters help us make it more versatile. I can change what it's doing outside of it using different values. Again, we need to picture that flow. Well, when it's passing in Mr. Blue, we are saying it's good to see you, followed by Mr. Blue. When it's passing in Mr. Purple, it's saying it's good to see you, followed by Mr. Purple. The name is changing depending on the value. In fact, what I just use parsing is how we often refer to this. We are parsing values to our, here it's a procedure, via the parameter. Let's end by looking at another example, this time using three parameters. So we're needing a procedure to output the largest of three numbers provided. Each of these three numbers should be input to the procedure via parameters. You must not use built-in subprograms in your procedure definition apart from print. So we need to write this definition, then call it with the values 5, 9, and 7. First of all, a comment like this in a question you don't see super often, but you do see occasionally. This is because they want you to sort of do the work yourself. There are lots of built-in subprograms to do stuff like this. So for example, in Python, you could use sum to do this really quite easily. But they don't want you to do that because they want you to write some longer code yourself. So that's what that's trying to say. Now, I want to find the biggest of three numbers. Well, this is more complicated than just two numbers, obviously, because I've got a third one. But adding a third one adds in more possibilities. So if I've got three numbers, N1, N2, N3, well, what am I just going to check for in my question? I need to check to see if N1 is bigger than N2 and N3. I want to check to see if N2 is bigger than N1 and N2 is bigger than N3. Then I've got to do the same process for N3. Is N3 bigger than N2 and is it bigger than N1? So that's got very messy very quickly. We also need to consider the fact that they could be equal to each other. We could have all three, which are equal to each other. We could also have two, which are equal to each other. And they might be bigger than the other one. They might be smaller than the other one. It just adds in a bit more complexity. So one to bear in mind as we do our if statements here. I think if statements are our best approach to doing this. We've got to try and cover every condition here possible. So before I do that, you'd get easy marks just for starting the procedure definition. Let's do ERL still. So procedure, we give it a name. It doesn't give us a name to use here. It doesn't give us an identifier. Let me just pick one. Let's call this biggest num. And our brackets need to have three variables in them, which let's just call num1, num2, num3. When I've got multiple parameters, I separate these with commas. Now, making sure I indent my code in the next line, what am I checking for first of all? Well, let's just do that first basic check to see if num1 is bigger than num2 and num3. Well, if it is, we're going to output, we're going to print, in this particular case, print num1. Now, we need to be a little bit careful here about covering all of our bases because I'm checking if num1 is bigger than num2 and bigger than num3. They're not always going to be bigger than each other. You might have situations where actually they are the same. If num1 and num2 are the same, then I need to check for this somehow. So the quickest way to deal with a situation where you have equality is just instead of using the greater than sign to use greater than and equal to. This will now, if I squeeze in this equal sign here, this will now check for equality. If we have a situation where they do happen to be equal to each other, all three parameters are equal, it'll print num1, which is the same as printing num2 or num3, assuming they are equal. And if you had a situation where num1 and num2 are the same, but it's still bigger than num3, well, this will still run because I'm not checking for equality only, I'm checking for greater than or equal to. And so I can copy the structure for the next line with an else if and do the same sort of thing for num2 this time. See if num2 is greater than or equal to num1, and greater than or equal to num3. In which case, I'm just going to print out num2. And then because I've used the equal signs to cover off the case where we have some which equal to each other, I can just use else at this point to cover off num3. If I hadn't compared based on equality, like I have done with equal signs here, I would have to add another else if to cover situations where they are equal. Because I've covered it already in my if statements, I can use else just to cover off num3. And at this point, I can end my if statement in ERL and I can actually end my procedure because I'm done with what the question has asked me to do. Or at least I'm done with my definition in my question. We are also being asked to call it with the values 5, 9, and 7. Well, what does this mean? It means below my definition, which slightly messed up my indentation, it looks like, but it's hopefully roughly indented at the same level. I can just below my definition call it by writing the name of our procedure, which is biggest num. And then I need to put in values for these parameters. So I don't just write num1, num2, num3 again. I've got to write in the actual numbers I'm being asked to pass in to this procedure. So 5, 9, 7. When this code runs, num1 becomes 5, num2 becomes 9, num3 becomes 7. So therefore it would run, therefore it would give us the biggest, which in this case is 9. So we have got to learn the structure of procedures. We've got to know when to add parameters and how to add parameters. Ultimately, the code inside the subprograms is just normal Python code or normal ERL code packaged within this procedure structure.